Bay. Chris Willingham, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You sound great.
Good morning, yeah.
Right next to me in studio, Brian Neitch. Good morning.
Hey, happy Tuesday. Good morning.
Tuesday, Brian Neitch.
Tuesday.
We're here.
Tuesday.
We're here. That was a beautiful song by Zach Williams called Turn It Over. If you like that song, go YouTube it and jam out today.
Yeah.
Just found it this morning, and we are here. We are on Job chapter 14.
Yeah.
And
we are.
Continues.
Job. Man, good old Job.
Good old Job.
Good old Job.
Yeah. Zach Williams is awesome, by the way. Love his stuff.
Fear is a liar.
Yes, fear is a liar.
Fear is a liar. I love that.
Yeah.
Come on in, chat board. Everybody open their Bibles. Chapter 14. We do read out of the New Living Translation. We have the King James here handy, and of course we have Hebrew ready to pull back. We started in Genesis 1:1 in April, and here we are, Job 14, cover to cover, all the way through. Thank you for joining us. And if you're listening for the first time, welcome. Grab your walking stick. Oh, Brian, I used to say that all the time.
Yeah, grab your walking stick.
I don't say that anymore.
Yeah, it's okay. I heard that before.
Grab your walking stick.
Yeah.
You don't need water or food because God will provide.
God provides. Yeah. There you go.
If you don't have a sword, sell your coat and buy one.
There you go. Yep.
That's red letters right
there.
Right.
That's red letters.
Yep.
Will Hawkinson, good morning.
Hey, good morning, Will.
Well, God is good. Jesus is king.
Yes.
Time machine. Here we are.
So Man. We have a church right now. We have Brian Neitch, Chris Willingham, myself, Will Hawkinson, God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit.
There you go.
That's the church.
We're done.
Good morning, Holy Spirit.
Good morning.
A lot of people didn't like this guy, but a great man of God, Benny Hinn, wrote a book called Good Morning, Holy Spirit. Amazing book.
That. Dogs.
I love Benny Hinn.
Go lay down.
I love believers. I love people.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm.
Now, we don't all believe the same stuff. You know, some of us believe X and some of us believe Y. But you know what we all do believe? Those of us who are born again, we believe that Jesus is Lord.
There you go.
That's it.
There you go. Yeah. We can squabble about a lot of things, but we agree on that.
Yes.
No matter what.
That is true. That is true. Amen to that. Let's do the countdown. Israel, drum roll, please. Brian's pulling it up.
629. Wow.
Broke into the 20s.
You're pushing towards that 500 mark. You know? Wow.
We're getting there. 10 days in Jerusalem.
Wow.
In the desert. Sand. I'm going to wear like a robe.
Are you now?
Sandals, walking stick.
Oh, I'm going all in.
You're
a beard.
You're going to be that guy who's what is that thing you wear on the top of the head, a tunic? Turban.
No.
Tunic is over your body.
I'm going to have the praying towel on my head.
the prayer shawl.
Shawl.
And you got to walk slow.
There you go. Walk slow.
You're like a Pharisee.
Yeah, the Pharisees, they're going to think he's a Pharisee. You're making fun of us.
I don't know. I'm just smiling and laughing right now. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
Jesus.
But I'm glad to be here. Jesus.
He's so good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going back and doing a study on like the early church fathers, and so I'm reading the early church history and stuff like that. And this guy was talking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and he said the reason that he thinks the Pharisees lasted was because the reason they fought with Jesus so much is because they had beliefs that were so similar, whereas the Sadducees didn't believe hardly anything Jesus believed.
Mm.
So the Pharisees were closer to the beliefs of Jesus, and they survived after the temple disappeared because they were more like the Christians that were around.
Hmm.
And so I thought that was interesting.
They were so sad, you see.
Yeah,
do you know who the first Christian to ever live was? This is a test to Pastor Chris Willingham live on.
Oh, wow.
Is this a trick question or is this a real question?
No, it's a real question. The very first Christian
Christian. That would have been the first person who saw the Messiah and confessed him as Messiah.
Yep. Who was that?
Confessed him as Messiah. Gosh, I want to say Peter because he made the confession.
No.
Okay. Then it's Andrew or Philip.
I know.
Well, John the Baptist is there, but he doesn't make the confession.
John the
Baptist leaps in his mother's womb.
Yep.
But he doesn't see the Messiah at that point. Now he sees him when he baptizes him.
But in the stomach, doesn't John the Baptist say that's Jesus?
Well, yeah, he leaps.
He's not born again.
He's not born yet.
But if he's in his mother's womb,
yeah.
Yeah. and he knows that Jesus is Lord in Mary's
stomach. He responds. He does respond.
Then that means he was saved in his mother's womb.
Mm-mm.
Well, okay, but see, here's the thing. To be saved in the way that we would say it today, Jesus has to come and make the sacrifice. So Jesus has to die.
That's right.
Resurrected. So it would be after his resurrection that we
this
would
is have such fascinating.
Well, let's go back to the words of Jesus. He said in the book of John, chapter 3, you must be born again or born from above. So John the Baptist wasn't born from above yet. Right. He was still born from Adam.
Okay. Mm-hmm. This is a fascinating conversation.
Yeah.
But John the Baptist then believed in Jesus.
Yes, he did.
Believed in Yahweh, of course, right?
He did. Right?
So even in his mother's womb,
yes,
he had the angel waiting to take him up to Abraham's bosom.
Okay,
even in his mother's womb.
Counterpoint to that, then couldn't you say Abraham was the first Christian?
That's right. You could.
Or Noah. Or
Adam.
I mean, we would have to go back, because I think the dividing line for a Christian is Jesus has to be resurrected, right? In other words, it has to be finished. And then the people after that.
Yeah, because, hey, check this out. Oh, Jonathan. I guess Pinky, the dog.
Yeah.
I'll wait to bring my point up. But I'm gonna bring up Genesis chapter 3 all right, here's my point.
Okay.
If you really want to go there, you have to say it has to be Adam, because Adam and Eve were told by God in Genesis chapter 3 that the Messiah will come and stomp the enemy's head once and for all.
Yep.
And he didn't name him. He didn't say Jesus is the Messiah. But guess what? We don't know if he might have told them. And he, you know, but they believed God. Ouch. Just because they messed up that one time didn't mean they were sinners forever.
Same.
Yeah, we're talking about belief. That's different, because believe in Jesus, you do have to go back to Adam, because the promise is made. But but I think
I know who it is, though.
Question. Yeah.
I'll tell you right now. Here's the answer. Uh-huh. The answer to your question, John, is Mary.
Mary.
She was in the garden. Oh, she saw him raised from the dead first, and she said, Lord.
Yeah, Mary.
And guess what? He's like, boom, you're in. But I don't know, because he still hadn't done the services that he needed to go to heaven and do.
For your point, Ryan, that means John the Baptist, if you're going to go on the Mary point there, was the first person to know that Jesus was Lord.
Oh, actually, wait a minute. It would be Mary, the mother of Jesus.
Mm-hmm. She did.
At the moment of conception that he was the Messiah.
Oh, that's right. She was.
Back to her. But again, I think knowledge of the Messiah is not the divining point. It is those who now accept Jesus as the sacrifice,
right?
Which has to come.
No, but you're right. But Chris, he jumped with joy in his mother's womb.
That he knew the Messiah.
He didn't just say, "Oh, that's Jesus." He said, "That's Jesus, the Lord, and I believe in him in his mother's womb."
Well, he recognized the Messiah. That's all we know. We don't know. He didn't say anything.
But
he does recognize the Messiah.
Yeah. So here's the other thing. The Bible says that he went down into Abraham's bosom. It doesn't say exactly like that, but he went and preached to them. He preached the gospel. Yeah. He preached the kingdom of God has come.
Yeah.
I am the kingdom of God and I have come. So that is why would they, if they believed, which they did, they all believed the Messiah was coming.
Right.
And John was in there.
Yeah.
John the Baptist, the last prophet before Jesus.
Yep.
If he was in there, they all needed still to be rescued from Abraham's bosom.
Yeah.
And if that's the case.
Wait. Go ahead.
Yeah. If that's the case, then he needed to go in there and announce, I am he.
Oh, and he definitely did.
Yeah.
Question. Did John the Baptist die after Jesus risen?
No, he died before. He dies early in Jesus' ministry.
In fact, John 11:35 is the book of John 11. It's the shortest scripture of all. Of course, that's Lazarus. Never mind. But he was very sad about him. You know what happened? Jesus heard John the Baptist died.
Yep.
And he was moved. He was upset. But then the Bible says he saw the crowd and he was moved with compassion and he healed them all.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But it was his cousin. John was the Baptist was his cousin.
That's right. Now, I can tell you who the first Christian was in Europe.
Who?
This is actually stated in Scripture. Mm. The first convert in the continent of Europe was a woman named Lydia.
Lydia, that's right.
Yeah, whoa, she was a seller of purple.
Really?
Purple robes, purple dyes, and things like that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's one on the left arm.
Yeah, she was a businesswoman, and she was the first convert in Europe.
Another famous woman.
So the first convert to Christianity would be Mary Magdalene, right, at the tomb.
I would assume.
She's right. The first one to see the risen Christ and right. acknowledge him. And the first woman in Europe to be, it's woman.
Wow, both women.
And women and women.
You know, yeah. A lot of
when
women.
You go back to the garden, that Eve, you are going to be the one who has the, she starts the line, right?
Right, she does. I think God loves women more than men.
And you know, no. But you know what? A lot of times women believe. You know what she said?
I was kidding, but.
Good.
He loves me more than all.
Loves everyone.
Yeah. What? What? You were gonna say? What'd she say?
Mary. She said an amazing statement that we can all adopt. She says to the angel. He just prophesies to her. He says he brings the word of the Lord, and she says, "Be it unto me according to your word." And that's all she said and believed. Just like the centurion, Jesus, yeah. Whatever you say will happen. Just right. Say the words, and my servant or my child will be healed. Servant
healed. Yeah.
Amazing. It's so much we discount, especially nowadays, so many people and religions and denominations and communities discount believing in the word of God.
Yeah.
They think I got to do. I got to go and I got to clean and I got to sweep the church and anoint the the pews and all that is great.
Yeah.
But believe Jesus, that's the answer.
Right.
That's really all of us. That's really all we have to do. That's what he calls us to do. Believe.
I want to do that.
Yeah. The good works comes after the believing. We are created unto good works. We're not created to do good works to earn our salvation. We're given salvation so that we can do the good works that were created for us beforehand.
Right.
I have a question for you both, pastors here. And I'm just sitting back listening to you both, learning so much. And this is an interesting topic, by the way. This is fun. It's just interesting because we always talk about pre-Jesus and post-Jesus, but it's like, what about the time when Jesus,
right?
It's just interesting that John the Baptist went to Abraham's bosom before he went to heaven, even though he believed in Jesus, right? That's interesting to me, which is awesome though. Hey, question for you both. Mm-hmm. Do you think that when John the Baptist got to Abraham's bosom, he's like, guys,
I saw
everybody come here.
You're not going to believe
this. Do you think
this.
That he honestly was preaching everything that's happened before Jesus obviously walked in the front door? Do you think he was preaching?
Yeah, I'm sure.
100%.
You couldn't shut John the Baptist up.
Oh, I'm sure. All of them before John the Baptist.
Yeah.
Because look, he had already started his ministry, healing signs and wonders that happened. John was like, "What's happening? Are the signs happening? Are people getting healed?" Mm-hmm. And he's like, "Go tell John." Jesus says, "Go tell John. Yes, the lame are walking, the eyes are opened, the dead are raised." Yeah. So people are already getting saved, and I'm sure some of them had died. So you have a plethora of people saying, "Oh, another person's coming. Come on, tell me. Is it really happening?"
Yeah, John, that's actually a fascinating question. Now that you ask that, it really does fascinate me because think about this. So so Adam dies. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And he dies believing in the Lord because he's walked with the Lord.
Right.
So he goes, there's not a bosom of Abraham that they would call it at that point. He goes the same because Abraham doesn't exist,
right?
But we're saying it's a place.
Bosom of paradise or something. Paradise.
So he goes there and he's there.
Okay.
But then Abraham comes along and says, "You're not going to believe what I saw."
Oh my God.
And he tells Adam, and I was like, oh wow, I'm seeing it come true. And then Moses comes along and says, "Hey, you're not going to believe what I saw."
I have goosebumps.
They're just piling the
what
story
the
out.
Oh, I know. And then Job shows up.
"Saw him. I was with him. I touched him. I baptized him." And they're like,
and
yes.
Ruth is like, "I'm so glad I went with Naomi."
Right. Yeah. I mean, so all those glad
wait,
Ruth and
wait,
Job.
You forgot one thing.
Hmm?
Adam, every time someone new shows up, Adam's like, "I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Ate the fruit.
I'm sorry.
No, he's fine.
But he's got to be excited to go. It's happening. It's
amazing.
Happening. And then, I mean, and then think about it. If we're walking this progression of things, Jesus dies.
Yeah.
Preaches, "I am the Messiah. I am the way, the truth, and the life."
Oh yeah.
resurrects, and then these people are taken from that place that they've been in.
What? Yeah. What about this? Hold on. Let's
imagine him walking in.
Step it back a little bit.
Yeah.
John, like you're saying, he walks in and he's not born again yet. He's in there for 3 days, however long that is, right? Days and nights and everything. He's like, I don't know if he goes into the lower parts of hell first. I don't know, whatever. That's a conversation. But at one point, he's hanging out with these people, his crew, in paradise, in Abraham's bosom, right? And he's like, all right, guys, it's about to happen. It's going to happen. You ready? Like, you're going to change. Yeah. Everything is kind of the spirit, remember the spirit that talked to you? He's going to live on the inside of you.
Right.
And so you're going to be, oh my God.
Went from Abraham's bosom to heaven, right? Yeah. And they had to like, all right,
back it up, boys.
Go to Home Depot, get the cardboard boxes, right. Rent the U-Haul.
Oh my God.
Did all the angels take everybody up to heaven? Because we know Jesus and Luke said about the beggar, an angel.
Yeah. If we use that as our story, then yeah. I mean, if we use that as our prime.
So millions and millions of angels flew everyone up to heaven.
Could have happened. You know, I'm sure, you know, God could have also done something special. He could have said, well, bam, everybody's in heaven. Because this is a new thing.
Right.
Right. Now, no longer is it earth to heaven. Uh-huh. I mean, excuse me. No longer is it Abraham's bosom in the belly of the earth, born again, rushed up. Now it's born again, die from earth to heaven. So it's a different process.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know. The answer is yeah.
Yeah. So imagine Adam all this time hearing these stories, and then Jesus shows up and Jesus meeting Adam.
Oh my gosh.
Adam's like, you're the completion. You're what we've been waiting for. Since the time I walked with God, you're what we've been waiting for.
That's right. Yeah. You know, John. I have
goosebumps. It's
crazy.
Chris, you probably know this. But the Bible calls Adam, the first Adam. And Jesus is called the last Adam.
That's right. Yeah.
Oh, really? That's in the Bible?
Yeah. You know why? Here's why. Yeah. Because.
Interesting.
Here's why. The book of Genesis is very particular about words. And it says that in the beginning, he created the male and female in the image of God, he created them.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you go to the book of chapter 4, I believe, Adam and Eve, they had a baby, Cain and Abel and Seth. And it says that Seth was created in the image of Adam.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Not the image of God. Now it's close. Yeah. You have a spirit, you have a soul. So all these people who always preach and teach, oh, we're created in the image of God. Well, not really. Actually, we're really close, but we're created in the image of Adam, which is a fallen spirit, right? Yeah. We're created in the fall as a fallen spirit, as a spirit not connected to the Most High.
Yeah.
So when the Bible says that he was the last Adam, we are now reborn in the image of God as him. We are him. It's amazing. It's phenomenal. Yeah. And that's the only way you get to heaven. You don't get to heaven by doing something.
This is the middle time where we must preach Jesus every day.
That's right.
Yeah, come on.
This is the middle time right here.
Phenomenal. I'm chills everywhere.
All have fallen, and through one man, all are redeemed.
Yes.
We got to preach Jesus right here, right now, because this middle time is so important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it truly is faith. And it's crazy to think that even when Jesus comes back, people won't believe because the devil will try to trick them.
Yeah.
You know?
That's right.
There's no more important, I was saying this earlier to John, there's no more important message, right, than that Jesus died and rose from the dead, and he gave us eternal life. That's it. That's the only, that's the message.
He didn't come to condemn, he came to save.
Yeah. And he didn't come to lock us in chains to do thou command you to. No. You know, there's really no commands in the New Testament. It's follow the Spirit. That's what it says.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart.
Well, we should read because we'll be here all day.
Yeah, we will.
I love it. I love it. And interesting conversation. Fascinating. Yeah. I've learned a lot.
Even Job is down there. He was down there with him when Jesus got there.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah. So Job doesn't have it that bad after all.
All right. Just hang on. Remember, this story is only about a year, a little less than a year of his life.
Well, let's, Chris, you're our special guest, so I'd love to have you pray it in.
Yeah, let's
Will pray. Hawkinson, you still with us on the chat? Who's on the chat here? Hey. Jump on and say hi. We'd love to see you guys with some waves, but go ahead, Chris. Sorry.
That's good. Oh, Father God, thank you so much for just the conversation we've had, and to be able to think deeply and with wisdom, hopefully, about your word, about what you said, Lord, that we appreciate all that you're telling us, that you have given us these stories from the Old Testament that we're reading about real men and women who lived and who had real encounters with you. Mm. And you haven't stopped doing that. That wasn't just the Old Testament. It wasn't just the New Testament. It is modern day. Mm. You have not stopped pouring your Spirit out upon us. And so, Lord, we're thankful for your Spirit, the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, guiding us, pulling us together, drawing us into relationship. And so as we read your word today, as we continue on the saga of Job, let us hear your word, Lord, more than any man's, more than any person's perspective. Let us hear you, mm-hmm. your word, Lord, so that we can be blessed. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right. Will's still with us. Awesome. Will Hawkinson. Let me just,
yeah,
grab this.
You want to move that over there so you can get to it?
That's good. Yeah. All right. Well, Brian, you want to kick it off here on
Sure. Job 14. Let's do it. Verse 1. How frail is humanity? How short is life? How full of trouble? We blossom like a flower and then wither. Like a passing shadow, we quickly disappear. Must you keep an eye on such a frail creature? And demand an accounting from me. So must you keep an eye on such a frail creature and demand an accounting from me? Who can bring purity out of an impure person? No one. You have decided the length of our lives. You know how many months we will live. We are not given a minute longer. So leave us alone and let us rest. We are like hired hands, so let us finish our work in peace. Once again here, look, Job is still like, I don't know, God. I think it's, you're bugging me, you're hurting me, and it took it all away. He still doesn't equate the evil side of the world, you know?
I love how this is, though, I know I say this a lot, it is a good reminder. Mm-hmm. That we're not here long.
Yeah. Right.
And that we must love our family, mm-hmm. and our friends, and yep. spread the word of Jesus.
Good yeah. point.
And stay in the word and mm-hmm. just wake up in the morning and just thank God
yeah.
every day, because yeah. we are not here long.
Yeah. We work while the sun is still in the sky, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And that fall morning this morning, by the way.
Nice.
It was cold outside.
60 something degrees.
Boy, it felt great.
It was nice. Right.
It felt great.
Yeah. Yes, it did.
7. Even a tree has more hope. If it is cut down, it will sprout again and grow new branches. Oh, its roots have grown old in the earth, and its stump decays. At the scent of water, it will bud and sprout again like a new seedling.
Yeah, what Job's missing here, mm-hmm. and I'm not judging. I'm just saying, if I was able to talk to Job right now, I would mm-hmm. say, look up, child.
Yeah, right.
Like the Lauren Daigle song.
Right.
Because you got your eyes too much on earth.
Yeah.
Well, he's looking at his skin. Yeah. You know, he's looking at his feet. He's wearing like underwear only, you know, like a sack. Yeah. He's hurt. He's scratching. He's hurting. Yeah. I mean, the guy is just in misery.
Right.
Everything
in the mortal life is miserable.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's all he sees. You're right, John. That's all he sees. He just sees the right here and now.
But, you know, that brings up a good point, because so theologically, when we talk about Jesus, we'd say he's dual natured, right? He's spirit. He's 100% God, 100% man. He is spirit and flesh. And we're dual natured in the sense that we are spirit and flesh, too. But the way God says it is that we are equal parts. But if you look at the way we live, I live like 98% in the flesh and like 2% in the spirit. You know what I mean? I don't think about the spirit as much. The flesh is demanding my every thought and attention.
Mm-hmm.
how I feel, you know, is my hair right? The weather outside, what I'm putting in my stomach today, what I'm going to get tomorrow, what I'm going to watch on TV.
Right.
My life is filled up with the flesh, but God says, I made you to be both. I made you to be spirit and flesh together. And it's like we live in one world and acknowledge the other one.
Wow. Interesting.
And that's exactly right.
Yeah. And that's what I think that's what Job is doing here. He is totally in God. And the more painful the flesh, the less we look at the spirit typically, you know, which I think is where Paul is different. Paul tends to live much more in the spiritual side of things, I think, which is, I think, is why he can be happy in prison, you know? But yeah, I mean, I just feel like at least for me, I feel like I live
that's why
so much more.
Speaking of prison in that, like Joseph.
Yeah.
The second Pharaoh or the first Pharaoh got him.
Yeah.
He was in prison and he was just whistling and praying and smiling. And people are like, why is this guy so happy in prison? You know, his brothers sold him out.
Yeah.
It's because he was looking up.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know what Paul says in Second Corinthians, he's telling the Corinthians, which was a hellacious church at times. They were like sinners and adulterers and murderers. I mean, in their heart, and hated each other and glutton. Anyway, people, they were just people, right? Yeah. Born again people, spirit filled people who just acted up. And so Paul goes, even though we walk in this flesh, we don't war after the flesh, right? Or we don't fight in the flesh, right? We do all of our work in the spirit first, right? Yeah. We pray and we believe God and we trust him and we confess the word over our problems and the scenarios. And and that's exactly what you're saying, Chris. We need to take that 2% and switch it to where we're living 50-50 or 60-40 or 78-20 or whatever it is, 80-20 spirit, 80-20% physical, whatever it is. Because the more you do that, the more you practice the spiritual walk, you know, the closer you get with the Lord, the louder his voice is, the more it's clear you can hear him say, no, turn right.
Yeah.
No, put that suit on.
Yeah.
No, call this number. No, just be patient. Wait 10 days. And we right now, we're just like, I want it. I got to have it. I
want it now.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I'm that way.
Oh, I'm 100% that way.
You know? Yeah. What, shiny? There's a squirrel.
Right. And why can't I have that? I want that.
Squirrel.
Exactly.
The girl in Willy Wonka sometimes. But I want it now.
Oh, yeah, Daddy. Exactly. I want it now. That's great.
Find Delula or whatever her name is.
Yeah, whatever.
You want me to hit this paragraph?
Yeah, where are we?
10?
10?
10.
I'll hit this paragraph here. Verse 10. But when people die, their strength is gone. They breathe their last. And then, where are they? As water evaporates from a lake and a river disappears in drought, people are laid to rest and do not rise again. Job, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Until the heavens are no more, they will not wake up nor be roused from their sleep. Okay, hold on. Pause real quick.
Yeah.
Is Job before Moses?
Yeah.
Job is after Abraham.
Yeah, he's after Abraham.
So
remember, this is not Job. This is not exact truth. This is Job's mind.
Poetic.
I know that. That was not what I was saying. I was just saying, why is Job not acknowledging heaven?
Well, I think he is. If you notice, he says, until the heavens are no more. He doesn't say they never wake up. He says, until this world passes away, the heavens are no more.
Yeah,
that's his poetic way of saying that. So even he believes in an afterlife. He believes there's something afterwards.
And then why does he say, we're no more and we're just going to die? Yeah. And like, it's just so gloomy, right? Rather than saying, I'm going through tough times. I'm going to die here on earth, but my spirit will raise and I'll have eternal life.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
he's saying until then, it's just pain.
Well, you have to think about it, right? Put yourself in his spot right now. So even though he believes, like the Bible says, right, he was upright, you know, before God, meaning he believed God. He was a righteous man. Didn't mean he did everything perfect. He wasn't sinless, but he was a righteous man before the Lord. He believed him. He had faith in him. You know, he probably gave to a prophet or somebody or a priest in service or whatever, you know, all the things that he should have done that was in his area. He didn't have the Tanakh, right? He didn't have the Bible.
Right.
But what he had was the knowledge of God. And he probably convened with him, right? Who knows? The Lord might have showed up sometime and said, Job, I love you. Or something. You know, remember, there's a lot of prophets who were like Baal, who were not Israelites. And right. Job was not an Israelite, right? I think the history says he's like from the line of Esau. So yeah. So he wasn't, you know, in the line that got the Bible or even all that teaching. Yeah. So he's doing the best he can, right? He doesn't know it all like we do. And we have like, 20 That's books. Good, like,
hindsight's 20/20, yeah. right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And remember, he's in the midst of death because not only is he suffering, but he's lost his children.
Right. What is he like 2 or 3, 4 weeks into it?
Yeah. His servants have been killed. He's death is fresh on his mind. And he's saying, even they're better off than I am. I mean, even they're laid in the grave better than I am.
His sores are still oozing. You know? Right.
It's very fresh. This is the wounds are fresh, literally.
I think, Chris, you want to hit 13?
Yeah. I wish you would hide me in the grave. There we go. And forget me there until your anger has passed. But mark your calendar to think of me again.
I love that. That's great.
That's mark your calendar, Lord.
I love that.
All those weightlifting meets coming up. Mark your calendar.
I wish you would put me in the grave and let this pass, but don't forget me. I mean, I'm still here, you know? Yeah. So again, he's still expressing belief in that God is going to redeem.
That is awesome.
You know, but mark your calendar.
I wonder what the Hebrew is on that.
Yeah, I'm going to look at the King James. Hebrew calendar.
Yeah, that's interesting.
That's awesome. Mark your
calendar.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. He's telling God to mark his calendar. That is so epic. That is like God up there in his kitchen and he's got a calendar. He's like, all right, I got to mark it here.
It literally says, but mark your calendar to think of me again.
That is. Okay, I was going to look it up.
That's fascinating.
Mark your calendar. Don't forget me, God. Mark your calendar. And then verse 14, can the dead live again? If so, this would give me hope through all my years of struggle, and I would eagerly await the release of death. You would call, and I would answer, and you would yearn for me your handiwork. For then you would guard my steps instead of watching for my sins, my sins would be sealed in a pouch and you would cover my guilt.
Cover. That's Jesus. That's interesting. The blood of Jesus covering the sins of humans.
Yes.
You know, but that's interesting how now he's really starting to get back on track here.
Yeah.
Well, this is also, he's thinking of, you know, this whole atonement concept, you know,
that's right.
You know, that's like, that's in the air and it's about this time that it's happening. Right.
Right,
God dealing with Moses, and I mean, I would assume it's similar time frames. And it's like, hey, I'm here. I'm here to make a way, and here's the way. Right, here's my covenant. Yeah. Here's the beginning.
It's like, don't you wish you go back and answer his questions? Can the dead live again? Yes, they can. Job, by the way, can my sins be forgiven? Yes, they can. Yes, they will. You know, he's asking all the right questions.
You want to talk to him so badly.
I know. But,
look at 15. You would call and I would answer.
I would answer.
And you would yearn for me your handiwork. Look, it's just like this prophecy of like, this is what I hope for. It's coming. You know, it's coming. Then you would guard my steps. He does guard our steps, right?
Yeah, right.
Instead of watching my sins, and he doesn't necessarily do that, but he sees us, you know, before this time. Clearly, he can tell.
It's just hard for us to read. Think about God, being up there, just going, "Oh, Job, only if you know,
right.
You know,
keep trusting, buddy."
You'd yell, "Jesus is up there! It's coming, boys! Don't worry, I'm coming." Oh,
Jesus is. Well, I never mind. I was saying he's combing his white horse, but no, he's coming in on a donkey the first time.
Yeah,
he's like, get that donkey ready, baby.
Get it ready.
But he makes the entrance. All the heavens, you're not there. We're not there yet, but the heavens show up, and all the angels in heaven sing.
That's right.
Hosanna! King, the peace on earth and goodwill toward men.
When Mary gives birth.
Yeah.
Yeah. That night.
That night. Like, can you imagine? The atmosphere is probably just lively.
Oh yeah, because all heaven's been waiting for this moment. They're like, tonight's the night.
Yeah,
you know, tonight's when it happens.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's going on the left arm.
That's why you sing the Christmas songs, right? They mean something.
Mm.
They're amazing. This Christmas might be a different Christmas for you, John.
It really will be.
It gets better for me every year.
It's interesting how I got saved in 16, but the thing is that like reading the Bible, I just look at everything so differently now. you know, that's just what you got to do. All right, who's up?
Chris, 18. But instead, as mountains fall and crumble, and as rocks fall from a cliff, as water wears away the stones and floods wash away the soil, so you destroy people's hope. Yikes. Man.
Jeez, Job.
I felt like saying that before, though. I get him. Yeah. There's been moments. You always overpower them, and they pass from the scene. You disfigure them in death and send them away. They never know if their children grow up in honor or sink to insignificance. They suffer painfully. Their life is full of trouble. So in Hebrew literature, when you get poetic stuff, there's always a, it's like a, there's a, an opening statement, and then it comes to a point, and then comes back to the opening statement at the end. It's he ends it the same way he starts it, that appear full of trouble. Humanity, how short is life, and full of trouble. And then at the end, they suffer painfully. Their life is full of trouble.
Yeah, did you notice this reciprocates his thinking, what's happened to him in the beginning? This is all he knows currently.
Yeah.
This is all he knows. This is his kids.
Right.
This is exactly what he thought.
Yeah, he's continuing his argument with God from the previous chapter. Right.
He's still wrong here. And he was wrong in the beginning, and he's wrong now. And he's still doing it. He's like, my kids will grow up. They won't grow up in honor. They'll sink to in significance.
Yes.
And their life is full of trouble. Like, you know, he's still, you know, he's still like, no, here's a great takeaway from Job, because even though we're born again, and I mean, even though we're Christian, we follow Jesus, right? And so on. We're reading the Bible, we're studying. That doesn't make us perfect mentally. We still struggle in this world. Like in this world, there is tribulation, right? Right. We have to deal with heartache and problems, you know, relationships, you know, friends that are good and bad and so on. So Job's, it's a great takeaway. Like, even though Job is not correct here, he's still a man of God. He's still doing the best that he can with the knowledge that he has right now.
Right.
Right. And he's not backing down. And I know he's complaining a lot. He's like, oh, my Lord, you're killing everybody who's doing wrong, and I'm part of it, and put me in the grave, et cetera, et cetera. But look, the point is, we all struggle with the same thing. He's just overboard with his, you know, words.
Yeah, and he's just being honest with God. This is what I feel. This is what I see. From what I see of life, it looks like this, you know. And that's really a beautiful thing about God that we don't really give him credit for, is he allows us to ask those questions, to make those statements, and he doesn't despise us for it. He could, I mean, at this point, he ought to go, look, shut up, and just squish him. Yeah. But he allows him to do that. And that's important for our faith. Because without doubt, there is no faith. I mean, we think faith is just the people who never doubt. That's not true. It's like to say courage is somebody without fear. That's not true.
Mm-hmm.
Courage is somebody who's afraid, but does it anyway.
Right.
Faith is someone who has doubts, but believes anyway. So to see Job's doubt.
We don't know all the answers.
Yeah, is a function of his faith. I'm asking God these questions because I know he has.
You know, and you can even look back and you can look at this and say, look at how personal Job is being to God and the relationship that he has, even though it's complex and he's full of emotion.
Absolutely.
Like he's talking to God. How many people out there don't talk to God?
Oh, exactly. That's a good point. You remember.
Yeah.
And if you look at the life of Moses, like he had that transparent conversations with God also. God, what are you doing? You know, come on. Yeah. Don't leave me. What are you talking about? Or he would say, don't kill those people. The nations will know who you are. So he like,
I'm tired of him.
Yeah, exactly.
And then God even listened to Moses.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's like, okay. One of the reasons is like Moses is an example of why we should, and Job too, right? Why we should intercede for other people.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, Moses did it. Abraham did it. He's like, gosh, I just, you know, Lord, help them, you know? And, gosh, but he does. But my point is like, he's so close to God, and that's how we can be that way.
Yeah.
Can be where we're like, you know, I feel like this attack on me, Lord, God, I don't want to say it's you, but is it the enemy or is it me? And obviously it's not God, right? James says he's the father of good gifts. Mm-hmm. He gives good things away.
Mm-hmm. And again, I think that the person who wants to grow closer to God is going to have to be more honest with God about, God already knows, but if you want to grow close to God, be honest with God.
Say it ain't true.
Yeah. Tell him what you're feeling. Tell him what you're thinking. He knows it already. but expose it. Open yourself up and allow yourself to speak it and trust that God knows you and knows your heart and loves you.
Man, that's
what deepens faith. This, I'm okay. Everything's okay. Like we do at church. You know, how you doing? Oh, I'm good. No, you're not. But you're going to lie to everybody around you because it's easier to lie than to tell the truth, right? We can't be that with God. You just can't do it and get close to him.
So. But could you imagine though? Everybody that goes to church, how you doing? God, you know, I'm just doing terrible.
I feel like dying and going to Sheol.
I know. Right. God is destroying my hope. I'm washed away by the soil. Water's wearing me.
I was like, oh my gosh, this guy. Yeah, but I think that's what's also so good about communion. Something that even on this journey we've been on here on the podcast, we keep saying we're going to do live on air, but we haven't. Yeah. Maybe that's something we start doing. But
heck yeah.
Communion is so important. Yeah. Just to go and, you know, hit the ground.
Yeah.
Hit the ground.
Absolutely.
Know? And that could be celebration.
Oh yeah.
Or that could be put your face in the dirt and shed some tears.
Yep.
And put your forehead at Jesus' feet.
Yeah.
I've done that a few times.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, it could be either one or it could be mixed emotions, kind of like Job, where one minute you're celebrating, the next minute you're crying, whatever that is, like go to God.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Either way, go to God. Again, if you want to build a relationship with anybody, you have to open yourself to them.
Oh, yeah.
Same way with God. Not that he doesn't already know, but you need to open. That it's good for you to do that.
What a moment. Like if you decide to get close to the Lord, you start studying, you start listening, you start talking to him. The only good that comes out of that is good because you begin to analyze and expose yourself to yourself.
That's right.
Most people hide behind themselves. Yeah. They lie to themselves. They do stuff and I'll be fine. I'll be fine. That's great.
Right.
No big deal. I'll watch that. I'll eat that. I'll do this. No big deal. Right? We all do it.
Yeah.
But when you're intimate with God and he's right there, he's like, I thought you weren't going to do that anymore. What happened? What happened, Brian? What happened? Turn the channel. Right. Close your phone. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so it's like a good. It's like good to follow the Lord, and then it's good because you get intimate with him and yourself. That's really what people need, intimacy with themselves.
It's the best.
Yeah, it's also the hardest.
You know, that's why, it's the only path and the best path.
Yeah. Yeah, our community group was talking on Sunday, and I said, have you ever caught yourself, you know, like we say, we want to turn ourselves over to the Lord. I think they sing a song at church that really kind of, I surrender all, you know, 27 verses of I surrender all. And they kind of finished a song with that song. And I was asking my community group, I said, do we really surrender all, or is it just some or most of, or kind of some? I said, do we really give our children over to God and say, whatever you want to do with them, take them, you take them. If you want to put on the mission field, you put them. If you want to leave them here, you leave them here. I can't say that I honestly do, right?
Right.
Not many.
So I think it's a function of our faith to say, look, we are afraid to do that because, one, we believe falsely that we have control if we don't, which we don't have control.
Uh-huh.
And two, something in our background doesn't trust God. It sees him like an evil genie. Like if I tell him what he wants to hear, he's going to take everything from me, right? Like I'm going to be stripped of this stuff.
Well, where does that come from?
I don't know. I wondered if it came from, you know, I'm looking at, I can only know me. I was like, maybe something in my younger life.
Well, fear.
Wild fear. Yeah. They came in and told me God wasn't good.
So that's the darkness.
Yeah. But God is
fear.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. God is good.
Fear is a liar.
And here's the thing though. Just because you have fear in your life, right, of something, let's say your kids, that doesn't mean that you're the culprit. Like you can also receive fear from your family.
Oh yeah,
you can get it projected on you through a pastor, through leaders, through friends, you know, and they can convince you that you're not gonna it's not gonna go well,
yeah,
you know, and so that's why you always have to keep guard and keep what's in your ears and in your mind stayed on the Lord,
yeah,
yeah. This is the Fear is a Liar song, right?
Yeah.
You're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved. When he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough. Fear
you go, Chris.
Mm-hmm. There it is.
He's just saying.
Yeah.
Well, let's pray it out. I do got to get rolling and
got
some coaching ahead of me. But what a amazing, you know what? I'm just going to say it. Church service.
Yeah.
Because we already counted everybody. See anybody
we
else?
We read the word, right? Hey, we read the word together. We celebrated together.
You know, and who knows? Maybe John the Baptist and Ruth and everybody was up listening too.
Yeah.
So maybe we have more people listening than we think.
You're like, man, I lived it. I know.
You're like, yeah.
Job's like, I lived it. Just keep going.
Oh, yeah. Maybe Job's listening. He's like, oh, it's a good service, guys. Well, Brian, you want to pray it out?
I'd be happy to.
You're on fire. So,
yeah.
Well, Lord, we love you. We just come to you in the name of Jesus. Father, you've given us, gosh, so much. You've given us the Spirit of God to lead us, right? And every time we start this show, this service up, this church service up, right? This ministry to you and to the world. We just thank you for giving us the words and the direction and continuing to open our eyes, because all we want to do is be a light to the world, spread the message that Jesus has come and brought the kingdom of God for everyone, and to have an eternal life with you in a new and living way. So we love you so much, Lord. We just thank you for the grace today that we can accomplish anything that you have set before us, and we're going to do it because we are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Beautiful.
Amen.
Beautiful. Chris Willingham, thank you.
Thank you.
That was amazing.
Great day.
Wow, that first 10 minutes, too, was a fascinating conversation.
Yeah. It's
a fascinating conversation. So we'll see you guys back tomorrow morning.
Yeah, slow.